I have to stay a virgin my entire life just to keep my job. I can't ever marry or have kids. That sucks. If this is what being a fortune teller is, I don't want it. Miss Solitaire, I can help you get the life you've always wanted. I can help you find love. Live and Let Die, directed by Guy Hamilton, and is the 8th installment of the James Bond franchise, as well as the first ever Roger Moore Bond movie. So, Live and Let Die tells the story taking place after the events of Diamonds Are Forever, where Bond is sent to New York by MI6 to investigate the deaths of British agents, where he encounters a tarot card reader, Solitaire, as Bond attempts to free her from control of the ruthless crime master, Dr. Banger. Now, Live and Let Die, this is the Bond movie that presented the most significant change for the franchise, as this would be the first time a replacement actor for Sean Connery would go on to do multiple movies, not just one, unlike George Lazenby, and Roger Moore would be the most underrated James Bond for me personally. Live and Let Die, for his first outing as 007. I love it. So this is one of the top three best Roger Moore installments. Guy Hamilton, you nearly hit the nail on the head with your first directed Bond movie. And yeah, this would be overall my second favourite of the Guy Hamilton directed Bond flicks, second only to Goldfinger. But this is a huge comeback after Diamonds Are Forever. Roger Moore still holds the record for having the most movies of all of the James Bonds, so with a total of 7. So we still have 6 more Roger Moore reviews to come before his era is complete, and Roger Moore, he is the most charming of all the Bonds. He consistently has the hots for the Bond girls. He is the most charming and flirtatious with all the ladies. This movie is incredibly original plot wise by Bond standards, as it's Bond going off to investigate a smuggling plot. The smuggling plot is, thankfully, you're far more invested in it this time than you were in Diamonds Are Forever. But he's also investigating the unexplained deaths of three other agents, and so this movie is combining campy Bond with serious Bond, and it meshes that's a tone significantly better than most other Bond movies, and we finally get a antagonist that's involved with the art of voodoo. There's no Spectre in Live and Let Die, but I'm rather satisfied that we finally get a break from a Blofeld and Spectre after seeing Sean Connery fights them over and over again in his era. But Dr. Caramanga, my God, his design looks so similar to the Phantom of the Opera, but he's an all-arounder, possessive, a butthole. How he is literally controlling Solitaire's entire life, and he's using her to predict his future, and he's literally keeping her like his slave, just as Mother Gothel was holding on to Rapunzel so controllably and entangled. But Dr. Caramanga is even more evil than that. And Solitaire, she is one of the most sympathetic Bond girls I have ever seen, period. She, not only is Jane Seymour, well, not only does she look like such a stunning supermodel, you want her to be free and rid of Dr. Banga. You want her to be free to live her own life, and that's what makes her and Bond so close together, as he does care for her, unlike Dr. Caramanga. So with Bond, she can finally be true to herself and live a normal life, especially when she sleeps with Bond, that goes to show she's not afraid to rebel against tradition. And the other Bond girl in this movie, Rosie, she is this henchwoman, and I'm like, are you kidding me? Another henchwoman? Did you not learn from Bambi and Thumper in Diamonds Are Forever? I think they could have picked a different purpose for her character in this movie, personally. Give her some sympathy like you did with Solitaire. There's one boat chase sequence in Louisiana, which is a thrilling rise from the get-go, and there's even one sequence where Bond literally jumps over a flock of alligators, because crocodiles don't live in the United States, and just alligators. But yeah, this you know how jumping the shark is considered a negative to a movie? Jumping the alligator could be seen as quite the opposite. That could be seen as a major positive for a movie. And I have been on a trip to Florida. I have encountered alligators up close. So Bond knows no fear to do that. And I love how it's done with no CGI. It's an all a real boat and real alligators, and the title sequence with the fire and the Bond girls is it explodes with awesomeness, especially accompanied by Paul McCartney's bombastic and tremendous Bond theme, "Live and Let Die," which is one of the greatest and most listenable of all the Roger Moore Bond themes. Though I do feel the MI6 regulars, Money, Penny, Q, and M, contribute barely anything to "Live and Let Die's" narrative. And this is a real shame, as this was the first time they would be interacting with Roger Moore's Bond. And also, there's this cop character who is the Jar Jar Binks of the Roger Moore era. I just skip his scenes every time I watch this movie and The Man with the Golden Gun. And both movies come close to being perfect. So overall, Live and Let Die is a special game changer for the Bond series, and After seeing this movie, you will entirely move on from Sean Connery and accept Roger Moore in the role. Any hesitations or worries about Roger Moore taking over from Sean Connery just disappear.
I give live and let die 4 stars out of 5. Great movie.
Well, 1 Roger Moore Bond review down, 6 to go. Plenty more Roger Moore left. So, well, I love you guys. Thank you for watching. I hope you guys enjoyed this review. And what are your thoughts on Live and Let Die? Please comment and let me know. Please like this video and subscribe. And please follow me on Twitter and on Instagram. And I'll see you all next time when I have more special videos are coming your way. And remember, movies are us. Bye, guys.